So today I want to say a few words about fast rates for supervised and for semi-supervised multi-class classification. Assume that we have a standard classification problem. Namely, we have a set of n pairs, which is sample of labeled examples. We have a finite number of classes. We have a certain loss function associated with our misclassification. So in the simplest case, it's just a binary loss, so which is zero if we put correct class and one otherwise. So, and also we have a hypothesis set. So, and our goal is to find the best classifier, the classifier which minimizes expected risk. So, but what we can solve in practice, we can solve empirical risk minimization problem. So, and normally for such type of problems, we are interested in two quantities. First is generalization error. This means that how far is the error on unknown test set from the error on training set. And so the second quantity is excess risk, so which measures how far we are from the best classifier in our family. So, and here I will talk only about generalization error. So there are some misprints on slides. Sorry, I don't clean all of them. So what we want to provide state-of-the-art guarantees for generalization error. And so our primary focus is practice, because for us the problem is motivated by practice. So, and what we have normally in image recognition, we don't have too much labeled examples, but we have a huge number of classes. So the number of classes is more or less of the order of the number of labeled examples. So normally in, for instance, mushroom classification from ImageNet, we have about 1,000 objects and about 100 classes. Okay, so what we are doing in multi-class supervised classification, so I assume that we have different functions which assigns value or likelihood to different classes. So, and first of all, we are interested in margin of object X with respect to the other classes. So, and we introduce somehow empirical margin error, which penalize not only for the true error, but also for the error in sense that our margin is not high, huge enough. Okay, so there are some guarantees for that. So we see here that there are different dependence on number of classes and different dependence on n, where n is a number of examples. So, but okay, more or less all of them, except maybe the last one, which is due to Kalczynski and Panchenka, assume that we produce a slight modification of our classification procedure, or which another relies on sometimes quite strong assumptions. So in our work, we focus on the last bound, which is due to Kalczynski and Panchenka. And what we want to do, we want to remove here k square and put something which is less than k-square. And the other issue is that, okay, and what happens if our rates in n are faster than standard rates, and 1 over square root of n? What happens if we have rates almost like 1 over n? Okay, we know that it's possible under some assumptions, like margin conditions by Cibakov, or condition on random entropy. So might be the dependence in k will be also better than k square. Okay, so okay, I skip this. So okay, a couple of thoughts about notation. So this was a part of presentation for engineers, so sorry for this slide maybe. So this is standard notation like big O or big O after logarithmic factor, which involves in theorems. Okay, next. So okay, let's start with standard trait due to Kolchinsky. So he said that, okay, the following bound holds. Okay, we see that the bound have quadratic dependence in number of classes. So this is bad because if we have 100 classes and 1,000 objects, we can guarantee we cannot guarantee anything. So, and our first result is that, okay, almost in the same way as Kolchinsky and Panchenko works, the previous bound can be improved and improved by a square root of k. So, but anyway, it's a bit far from what we want because for 1,000 objects and 100 classes, we have here about something about 1, which is also not so interesting. Okay. So, and after that, we want to switch to the question I said before, that might be if we have faster rates in n, then we also have faster rates in k. So, okay. Here I remind standard notation of random epsilon entropy. So, and the next theorem states that, okay, it's really true. If our epsilon entropy is bounded and our empirical margin is good enough, then these rates are faster. Are faster not only in n, but also in k. So in the best case, when gamma is about 0, this leads to us the bound of order O of k divided by n. So it's easy to show that this bound is tight if we don't do any extra assumptions. Okay. So the question is, what happens if we know some additional information about structure of classes? So maybe it's reasonable to use here, and maybe it's really useful to use here. Okay. To understand what kind of assumptions we need, we switch to semi-supervised setup. So in semi-supervised setup, we also have not only unlabeled examples, but we also have a huge number of unlabeled examples, which are sampled from the same marginal. So, okay, assume the limit case that we have so many unlabeled data that we can reconstruct our marginal with a very good accuracy. So, and okay, what happens in semi-supervised setup? So semi-supervised assumption, which involves in okay, many algorithms, say that, okay, if you have dense regions, then we think that, okay, in each dense region, there should be not so many clusters. So it should be maybe one class. Okay, or at least two classes, not all the classes. So, there are different formulations due to different authors, for instance, Rigali or Chapley and Zien, or Goldberg once again. So, different formulation, but all of them say that, okay, optimal decision rule shouldn't cross very dense regions. So what we do a relaxation of these assumptions. We say that in each dense region, there shouldn't be a big number of classes. There shouldn't be all k classes, but maybe there are much less. Okay. So, okay, there are a lot of methods that use similar ideas. Okay, so just to omit some penalization for just to omit some extra concentration terms due to clustering methods. We say that, okay, we are working in the situation where data is perfectly well separated into M clusters. So, and we know these classes clusters a priori, and within each cluster there are no more than theta, where that is a certain parameter, different class labels. So, what happens if we don't know this information? So we can use any consistent clustering method like nearest neighbor classification or spectral clustering. So in the work referenced here, there are some results on consistency of these clustering methods. Okay, so roughly speaking, the picture is like the following. We have 10 classes here, but after clustering, we get 5 clusters, and in each of the clusters, there are not all 10 classes appear, but maybe 1 or 2 or 3. So if the number of classes is really huge, this might be useful. Okay. So the next theorem says that, okay, it's really useful. So if you know such kind of information, then we get here something which is more reasonable than k square or than root of than cube of root of k. It might be useful. So what we have in the best case? So if we know perfect separation of data into the clusters, and in each cluster, okay, 1 or 2 or 3 clusters classes appear. So then theta will be a constant, and this term will be of the order of square root of k. Okay, so now it's similar to Zhang result, who also get square root of k, but could we do still better? So just use the same assumption as we used before. So say that, okay, our random epsilon entropy of the class is bounded, and a certain condition on empirical margin is hold. So, and in this situation, if theta is constant, for instance, we get really small dependence on k. So, and if gamma tends to zero, then this tends just to theta, and this tends to 1 over n. Okay, this leads to to rates of the order of 1 over n, which with negligible dependence on number of classes. Okay, so okay, it's just back to semi-supervised setup. So okay, now we want to see, okay, the rates of convergence if we have huge amount of data. So it's really motivated by practice because, okay, in ImageNet database, you have about 1 million of images, but there are not so many labeled examples in real practical problems. The situation is just exactly the same. Okay, so what happens for convergence rates in this situation? So all these rates just based on several assumptions. So it's interesting to get, okay, this bracket should be here for sure. All these rates are based on certain assumptions. So, but okay, for instance, here we get in Karikinen paper, very beautiful Karikinen paper, we get slight improvement of these rates. So what we provide in our paper, we provide a set of bounds which are depend on certain assumptions. And so if strong assumptions holds, then okay, this bound is almost class free and almost as fast as 1 over square root of n. So if, for instance, we work with arbitrary class, but we know good decomposition of data into clusters, and in each cluster there are constant number of classes appear, then we have rate like this. So, and what happens if you know don't know anything? So, in this situation, unlabeled data is almost of no help, so no need to use it, and we get just back to standard fully supervised case. Okay, so this is just an experimental setup. Okay, but maybe here it's not so interesting. Okay, experimental setup for semi-supervised learning. So what we are doing, we just take a cluster decomposition, we analyze a cluster decomposition. If it seems that we have several dominating classes, then we preserve them and remove all the rest. If we don't see it, then we just remain the data in the cluster as is. So, and after that we learn with so-called pre-pruned data, and after get some methods and get some empirical results. Okay, I think that's all. So thank you for your attention.
I'm curious to know what kind of examples do you have in mind when you're taking k depending on n?
I don't assume k dependent on n.
Or of order n.
So the situation is like the following. So, okay, I didn't put images here, but okay. So in ImageNet we have different pictures of mushrooms, which can be on tree or on any surface. So these mushrooms are different. So it's like fun with data set. So different pictures. So maybe on grass. So I don't know English there. Okay, different fungi mushrooms. So, and so there are a lot of a wide variety of mushrooms. So about maybe 100 of classes. So, yeah, it's just an artificial, but nevertheless.
The sense of my question is that if you consider k times or k minus one times procedures that are built for the binary case, and if k is fixed, I mean, shouldn't this only affect the constant?
If k is fixed.
Okay.
And
so my question is, in some sense, when k is fixed, the question is already pretty much known.
If k is small, it's not interesting.
Yeah, so if k is large but fixed,
If k is large but fixed, it's interesting. Because, okay, in both cases, for us or for Kalczynski, Kalczynski has k square.
Yeah.
So, it may be 100 if k is, 10. We have just constants are almost the same. So we have, square root of 10 is about 3, so something like this. These are different quantities. So if here we have 100 classes, then k square is like this. And this quantity is 10 times smaller.
Okay. So your main focus is on
My main focus on really multi-class.
Okay, in terms of rates, the work is pretty much.
Yeah.
Okay.
Another question. So just to understand. So I mean, somehow get the use of additional information.
In the second part of work, yes. In the first part, so I mean this result, direct improvement. So we just use more accurate techniques. So and for
okay, so this is I don't discuss.
Okay.
But if you do, then you say you can somehow use the additional information.
Yeah.
And what is the idea of use of this unlabeled data? So few data labeled with a class belongings, and then you have some additional data which can, if I got correctly, you can only use it to cluster the data.
Yeah.
So you put the data in the clusters.
Yeah, I can say that prior my supervised learning, I have a decomposition of the main into a part, and in each part, so there are not so many classes. So when I do voting, I can consider only theta classes, not all the key classes. If my algorithm just supervised, it may be wrong. It may be wrong, but within these theta classes, then I get faster rates. If it misclassify in the following way, then. Okay. Assume that in this cluster, I have 1, 2, 3 labels, and I have, for instance, three. Okay. So if my algorithm just do misclassification, but like this or like that, but not do too much misclassification like that. So then I get faster rates.
Can I say, so you just split the domain into cluster with unlabeled data? And then for each cluster, you put the same which you would do for the whole data set, but now you have just much less.
Yeah, I have some information. Yeah. So, and in empirical setup, it's sometimes if you have enough label data, it's fruitful to prune extra noise.
But still, I don't know. You have. Then you have less data, less label data within each cluster. And if it's homogeneous, suppose you have homogeneous splits, I don't know, 10
the situation the situation is following that I learn functions, but I learn one function which k functions which classify all the domain, so due to maximum. I have, assume that I learned k functions, and after that I do some classification due to RMax rule. I learned this function based on the whole domain, but in a certain part of the domain, I understand that I have no motivation to see classes except this. This information is fruitful, is useful. So, and it can be used.
Isn't it that you compensate the lack of data in each cluster by the fact that you have the assumption of regularity of the posterior distribution on each cluster?
Yes.
That
some
compensates.
But when I do learning, I just use all the data. But this maximum, I used not all the functions. So it provides, as you say, some regularity. So, and it allows us to improve the rates.
We have time for one more question. In fact, if you are using really mount class classification, you can code your class number.
Yeah, I can use error correcting output codes and so on.
Are there any theory for that?
There are a lot of theory. So for error correcting
output codes. For error correcting codes, what the influence of this error correcting code coding on the generalization error of classification?
So if you, there are a lot of fields by Langford, which provides guarantees for error correcting output codes in terms of generalization error or excess risk. But we don't want to use error correcting codes. We want to use standard one versus all classification.
Right.
Because a number of papers, for instance, Rifkin paper in GMLR, which says that, okay, one versus all sometimes on practical data sets works much better than error correcting. Yeah.
Sometimes yes, sometimes no.
Yeah, sometimes yes, sometimes no. So, and we want to capture the situation when it works better.
Okay, well, thank you again.
Okay, thank you.